Hi everyone, our subject today is Caesar in summary. Febrile Caesar affects 3% of children have a genetic predisposition, occur between 6 months and 6 years of age. More than 90% of are generalized, lasting less than 5 minutes and occurring early in an infectious illness causing fever. Acute viral respiratory infection is the most common associated illness. Other infectious associated with the febrile Caesar: gastroenteritis, Shigella, Campylobacter, urinary tract infection, Rosella infantum. If symbol does not affect intellectual performance or risk of developing epilepsy. If complex, 4 to 12% risk of subsequent epilepsy. Risk factor for later epilepsy: fever more than 38.8 Celsius, Caesar lasting more than 15 minutes, more than one Caesar in the same day, focal Caesar, abnormal baseline neurological status, age less than 1 year, family history of epilepsy. Sorry, fever less than 38.8, not more than. Check serum glucose, electrolyte, calcium. Investigate non-typical Caesar with the immediate spinal tap and brain imaging and EEG at least 1 week after Caesar. A blue breath-holding spell occur in the some toddler when they are upset. The child cries, hold his or her breath in expiration and goes blue. Sometimes children will briefly lose consciousness but rapidly recover fully. Drug therapy is unhelpful. Attacks resolve spontaneously, but treating iron deficiency anemia if present may help. Reflex asystolic syncope, also called reflex anoxic Caesar, occur in infants or toddlers. Many have a first degree relative with a history of faint. Commonest trigger are pain or discomfort, particularly from minor head trauma, cold food like ice cream, fright or fever. After the triggering event, the child becomes very pale and falls to the floor. The hypoxia may induce a generalized tonic-clonic Caesar. The episodes are due to cardiac asystole from excessive vagal inhibition. The Caesar is brief, but the child does not always recover rapidly. Vasovagal syncope: children may faint if in hot and stuffy environment, on standing for long periods, or from fear. Clonic movement lasting a few seconds are common. Migraine may sometimes lead to paroxysmal headache, involving unsteadiness or lightheadedness, as well as the more common visual or gastrointestinal disturbance. In some young people, these episodes occur without headache. Benign paroxysmal vertigo of childhood. This is characterized by recurrent episode of vitiligo lasting from 1 to several minutes, associated with nystagmus, unsteadiness, or even falling. It is a primary headache disorder of childhood. It should not be confused with the benign positional vertigo. Hyperplexia. Attacks are characterized by excessive startle, may cause stiffening and collapse with the sudden jerk of all four limbs. Attacks are provoked by sudden unexpected stimuli, usually auditory. Hyperplexia need to be distinguished from seizure induced by startle. Other causes: cardiac arrhythmia, prolonged QT interval may rarely cause collapse or cardiac syncope, which may be related to exercise. Tics, daydreaming, night terrors, self-gratification. Young children may stimulate their genitalia, like pelvic rocking in high chair, looking preoccupied in order to achieve a feeling of comfort rather than sexual gratification. Non-epileptic attack disorder, functional seizure, medical unexplained seizure, and dissociative status. Fabricated seizures are fabricated by parents, induced illness, non-accidental injury, seizure from hypoglycemia, from an adult deliberate injection insulin, paroxysmal movement disorder, well circumscribed episode, genetically determined, no loss of consciousness. Top tips. Seizure occur during the neonatal period more than at any other period in children because of high incidence of infectious trauma to the brain, structural lesion of the brain, and metabolic disorder. Hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy is the most common cause of neonatal seizure. In a neonatal seizure, subsequent developmental delay, cerebral palsy, epilepsy, and death are related to low Apgar score at 5 minutes. The minimum workup metabolic screen in neonates include serum amino acid, urine organic acid, and blood lactate for mitochondrial disease. Prolonged seizure and responsiveness to anti-epileptic drugs and the need for more than one anti-epileptic drug to control the seizure are poor prognostic feature if in any seizure type. Hypomagnesemia, magnesium less than 1.5 mg per deciliter, is very often associated with hypocalcemia. The seizure will not respond to calcium, but intramuscular injection of magnesium will correct both conditions. Seizure occurring during the initial phase of sleep or on waking in an older child are suggestive of benign partial epilepsy, Ronaldic, 10% to 15% of all childhood epilepsy, or juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, 5% to 10% of all childhood epilepsy. Pseudo-seizure can sometimes be difficult to differentiate from epileptic seizure. Video recording and serum prolactin increase in true epilepsy can help. Red flag. Neonatal seizure may be the only sign of CNS structural abnormality, including malformation. Their recognition is critical as presentation is often subtle, such as oral lingual movement. Febrile seizure should be differentiated from meningitis. Children with CNS infection were usually unwell with the headache, vomiting, and lethargy before the onset of seizure, with more persistent postictal impairment or loss of consciousness. Focal seizures are often more serious than generalized seizure. Focal seizure can be the presenting feature of the herpes encephalitis or cerebral tumors. Timely neuroimaging is essential. Thank you for your listening.